That'll do. Thank you very much. Oh, marvellous. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome, year seven parents, to Borlase finally. I would really have loved to have had you on the site sooner, and I'm really delighted that so many of you have been able to come along to this afternoon's information evening. I know we have some parents at home as well, because of all sorts of reasons, but you know we do have some children in isolation, so welcome to you at home parents as well if you're there. We've taken this opportunity to also include in the information evening a performance of our year eight, which is normally our year seven cross-curricular dance project. So our year eight students were working towards doing a performance of the annual cross-curricular dance project with a view to performing it in the summer term, but everything got pulled towards the end of the summer term, so they weren't able to do a live performance. So it's a short dance project, but they're going to start by performing that to give you a flavour of what your children will be working on during the academic year of year seven. It's one of the units of work working towards a cross-curricular project. I'm going to say here that you can imagine that students, if they've been working to a deadline of last June, and then they've been off on quite a long holiday, and then they've come back and they're in different classes with different dance teachers, they've had two practices to try and get themselves reorganised, two short practices, and a number of them are out, so people have had to sort of regroup, etc. So I'm just saying on their behalf, this is their performance, but they've had to work quite hard to sort of make up for lost time and the gap in time that they've had. We do an annual cross-curricular dance project taking any number of themes from our curriculum. So in the past, dancers worked with chemistry, they've worked with geography, they've worked with modern foreign languages, they've done dances about, you know, the conjugation of verbs, they've done dances about volcanoes, they've done dances about various atoms, etc. Going pretty much through our whole curriculum over the years. This is a lovely project called Harlequin, which Miss Holmes is going to say a little bit more about to you, so I don't want to go into too much detail about that, but I hope that you'll enjoy it. We'll watch the dance and then we'll start the information evening. So welcome everybody, and am I ready to hand over to you, Miss Holmes? Excellent. We've got a little bit of a jumping down exercise here, so lights off, Will.
Thank you, good evening. I just want to talk to you a little bit about the importance of the creative curriculum here at Borlase. And during COVID, the world turned to literature, to music, to art, to dance. And those aspects of our lives in which we explore ourselves and our relationship to others and to the world. And I think the creative curriculum is the vehicle by which these skills of collaboration, making links, teamwork, self-reflection are developed. And the creative process, which we're going to see tonight, is also one which nurtures those core human attributes of self-expression, kindness, empathy, and tolerance. It also develops the imagination, abstract thought, and the processes of taking risks. So projects such as Harlequin are so important, especially in this post-COVID world in which we are all, in our different ways, healing. So, really, a huge thank you to Miss Chislett and the tech team, to Front of House and the prefects, to Year 13, Max, and to the Year 8 for their enthusiasm and their patience. Most of all, a thank you to Mrs. Ashby, without whom the Carnival of Colours would never have come to life. We hope that you enjoy Harlequin. Thank you.
Many years ago, in a small village in the Italian hills, there lived a boy called Harlequin. Harlequin was a lively boy, a boy full of tricks and mischief, a boy who had many adventures and many friends. If there was a squawking chicken being chased down the street, it would be by Harlequin. If delicious cakes mysteriously disappeared from the bakery, Harlequin would suddenly appear with a wide grin and sparkling sugar all over his face. If there were games to be played and dances to be danced, Harlequin would be the boy who ran the fastest, jumped the highest, and laughed the loudest. He loved his life and his friends loved him back. But on this night, Harlequin slept alone. The moon gently cloaked her mantle across the still body of the boy, and the stars murmured their silver soft ballad. Harlequin stirred, stretched his heavy limbs, and looked upwards to the reflection of the moon. He moved to his window, high above the dark cobbled streets and red angled roofs of the walled city. Wrapping a dark woolen blanket around him, he felt as if he were wearing the night. How he wished he could join the shadowy figures below him, silently moving in the narrow alleyways to the square in the centre of town. Some had left their homes high in the hills before nightfall to make the long journey to Bergamo. For the night to follow was the event of the year, the carnival of colours. Harlequin smiled a sad, small smile, pulled his blanket to his chin, and turned away from the gentle light at his window and the growing chorus outside. In the old square beneath the basilica, the atmosphere sparked with anticipation. Everyone was busy, smiling, laughing, hurriedly and excitedly talking about the most important part of the carnival, the splendid, rich, jeweled costumes they would all wear. In the corner of the sandstone square, the first to be lit by the breaking dawn sun, a group of friends gathered. They threw their arms around each other, dancing and spinning in circles with joy. Some of the children had not seen each other for such a long time. The mountain snow had kept them isolated in remote farmsteads with only their family and animals for company. Their excitement at the thaw of the snow had carried them down into the valley of the town and was infectious to all that saw them together. What love there is in friendship, one father murmured as he smiled at his daughter at her happiest. But then, slowly, one by one, the children stopped their dance. "Where is Harlequin?" asked one of the friends. "He should be here. He is always here to lead the fun, and it is the carnival. Where is he?" "I haven't seen him for days," said another. "Maybe he's ill?" "We must go and find him." One by one, the children disappeared through a narrow opening, and the corner of the square felt bare in the weak sun. Thank you. hewn blanket. The friends understood that Harlequin could not go to the carnival with them because he didn't have a new costume to wear. Each friend realized that they had enough spare material from their own costumes to give to Harlequin. This way, his mother could sew him a new costume, a kaleidoscope of blues, greens, yellows, and purples, a costume to dazzle and astound.
Thank you.
his friends, Harlequin embraced the darkness once again. The pieces of material lay scattered at his feet, a map of blue silk lakes, green velvet forests, and ochre deserts spread before him. But he could not navigate his way through the rivers and gullies that lay between them, nor could he fathom the network of tributaries, dark veins in cracked ice between them. "Mother, what shall we do?" the boy asked, his eyes hollow with doubt. Gently, his mother knelt beside him, one arm tenderly wrapped round the boy's slight frame. With her needle and thread, she led him through the dark green forests, over the blue silk lakes, and across the ochre deserts, trails of silver shining from her fingers. As she sewed, she sung softly tales of old. In her thread, she stitched lean wolves that ran in the forests, the mother of pearl shells hidden deep in the seas, the cold mountain winds that brought voices from other worlds through the mist. In her thread, Harlequin's mother fastened the future for her son, mapped his many journeys through the small town, his returns, his grief, his joys. In her thread, Harlequin's mother embroidered the life she had given to him. In every pull and every seam, her love gathered the material together, bound in silver. Square was alive with music of different kinds, the low beat of a drum and the high dancing of the piccolo, the reel of a violin and the shiver of a tambourine. Jugglers threw coloured balls high into the air, one after the other, so to keep your eye on them made you dizzy, and tumblers jumped, cartwheeled and flipped upside down in between and round the dancers and musicians. The smells of cooking food were irresistible, and children ran from stall to stall, trying to taste the sugary cakes and sweets that were piled high around the edges of the square. Suddenly, in the middle of the jugglers, tumblers, and dancers, a fantastic figure appeared. His costume was so bright, so splendid, that everyone stopped eating and dancing to stare at him. His costume shone and shimmered in the torchlight. As he began to dance, the colours whirled and twirled faster and faster into a kaleidoscope of blues, purples, greens, and yellows. He jumped higher and spun faster than anyone else around him, and his costume gleamed and flashed bolder and brighter than any others there. Nobody knew who this incredible figure was. Who is he? Where did he come from? Do you know him? The crowd gasped as the figure flew through the night sky. Then, one of the children recognized a piece of blue velvet on the costume of the dancer. It matched his own blue velvet jacket. Another, a piece of purple silk, the same as her long skirt. Another, a piece of green taffeta. Another, a piece of finely woven yellow wool. "It must be Harlequin," the children cried. "It is Harlequin! Harlequin! Harlequin!" the children cheered. Thank you. Harlequin's friends surrounded him and in a circle danced around him. And on this happy night, Harlequin, the boy without a costume, was the happiest and most grateful of them all. For he was clothed not in silk and taffeta and velvet, but in the kindness and love of his friends.